Should we wait until like 4:05? People are still trickling in.
Sitting by you, right before Mr. Ammon's class, because my mama couldn't afford new J's polo, thrift store, thrift clothes. That was all I knew. Do you remember? I remember when you laughed when I cut my perm off and you rated me a 6. I was like, damn. But even back then, with the tears in my eyes, I always knew I was the... I like that. Good evening, everyone. My name is Abi Lopez, and I'm working with a bunch of groups today to welcome Blair, Imani to campus. Today's theme is Navigating Justice and Self, a conversation with Blair, Imani. I want to shout out to our co-sponsors, the Stanford Speakers Bureau, QueerSalam, Queer Resources Center, Weiland, Ethics Society, and Stanford and Government for making this event possible. And another quick shout out to all the groups who worked with me to make this event happen, the Black House, the CSRE Department, NYSJA, the Black Student Union, Alpha Kappa Alpha, and the Black Law Student Association. So thank you to everyone for making this event possible. And now I'll hand it over to Professor Jennifer DeVere Brody, who will lead the event.
Hey everyone, welcome. I'm talking to you from the unceded Muwekma Ohlone homelands here in Northern California. And I'm so thrilled to be a panelist and moderator for tonight's very special event. I'm gonna just quickly introduce the other discussants and then our esteemed guest, Blair Imani. So tonight I will metaphorically be joined by Mohammad Gumma, who uses he, him pronouns and is a Black queer and Muslim junior from Southern California, majoring in Hum Bio and minoring in African and African American studies. On campus, he's involved in Black Community Services Center, who's here in the house. Thank you very much. He's a program associate there, and the Black Student Union, where he is co-president, and ASSU, where he co-directs racial justice. In his free time, as if he could have any there, he enjoys mentoring youth, discussing current events, and dancing to music from across the African diaspora. Also, we'll be joined tonight by Lina Karamali, who uses she, her pronouns, as do I, and is a senior studying in comparative studies in race and ethnicity, where I'm the faculty director, and she is also minoring in human rights. She worked for the Markaz, the Muslim Community Center on campus, for over 2 years, and now works at Queer Resource Center as the QueerSalam program coordinator. Lina is in the process of applying to law school, good luck. And in her free time, she likes to do creative makeup looks, getting involved with the Muslim and queer communities at Stanford, and social dancing. So we just couldn't be more thrilled to have Blair Imani, the critically acclaimed historian, outspoken advocate and activist, and dynamic public speaker, as you'll see in a moment. She founded Equality for Her, a nonprofit organization that provides resources and a forum for women and non-binary people to feel empowered. Blair uses her platform and social media presence, and if you haven't seen her Instagram, must do it, to organize and create awareness about injustices in Black, queer, and Muslim communities. She's also the author of two books, this one, which is one of my favorites, Modern Her Story, Stories of Women and Non-Binary People. Yeah, we got it in the house. And making her new book, Making Our Way Home, about the Great Migration, which is has a foreword by Patrice Cullors, one of the founders of Black Lives Matter. So many thanks for your time today. Thanks to all the audience members. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Mohammed to ask the first question. And thank you, Abby.
For sure. Thank you so much, Professor Brody, for that incredible introduction. So I guess to start off, Assalamu alaikum, Blair. I'm a big fan, and you know, your voice has been one that has personally impacted me in so many ways, so I'm greatly appreciative of this moment to kind of sit in this space with you. So I guess to kind of go into the first question, so in 2017, you came out on national television during your appearance on the Tucker Carlson show on Fox News. In the interview, you advocated for safe spaces for the Muslim, Black, and queer communities. And Carlson dismissed issues affecting these communities as politics, right? And you responded, some of us, like myself, exist in all of those communities. This is not identity politics when it's your life. Can you talk about what this experience meant for your personal and professional journeys?
Sure. I think the first thing to say is, first of all, thank you all so much. I really appreciate how intentional the organizers of the event and the panelists have been in recruiting all the different groups. So thank you to everyone who co-sponsored the event. I know that's not easy to do. I used to be a student organizer. So really thank you so much for bringing folks together. I remember when I first started speaking, it would be so difficult because I'd be on campus for one part of my identity group, and then the Black Student Union would get left out. And so it's really been beautiful to kind of see this evolve. Back to Tucker Carlson, highly don't recommend. You know, when I was growing up, I would often watch shows like Degrassi and really cling on to, you know, elements of representation, the Degrassi that Drake was on, Aubrey. And there was an episode where Marco, I believe, comes out on stage while his friends are basically, well, not his friends, his enemies, his bullies are telling, or you know, threatening to out him to his father, who's fairly homophobic. And he comes out on stage and really claims this moment as his own and really flips the script from, I'm not going to let these people out me, I'm going to out myself. And it's still under duress, right? It's not something that he got to do on his own. But I always thought that was such a hyperbolic, like who comes out in such a public way? That's so weird. Flash forward to me coming out on Fox News on national television. And so it wasn't something that I had planned. You know, I did work in communications for quite a while. The year prior to me going on Tucker Carlson, I was working at Planned Parenthood as a communications organizer, working like kind of at the crosshairs of research and then also looking at just basic communications and organizing. We would take studies and research about how people would move the needle on talking about abortion stigma and implement that into our messaging. So I felt very cocky about it. You know, I was like, okay, this is my first big girl job. I can do this. Tucker Carlson wants me to speak about safe spaces, cake. I got this. I didn't really know the situation I was going into, so lessons we're learning from here immediately. Always know the context you're going into. Definitely believe in yourself, but also have enough humility to know the context you're stepping into. And I have friends who are like, wow, Blair, that was such a strategic move for you to come out on television. And I was like, yeah, had it been a strategic move, but it was actually just me getting caught up in the moment. We were in a studio, an environment like this, and I know you've gotten into it with your own Zoom calls where you're just in your space, you're comfortable where you are, you start expressing yourself and you're like, oh snap, I'm sorry, I'm in class with 40 different people. And so that kind of happened with me, except I had forgotten that I was on television. I was just talking to this dude who wasn't listening to me, who was really gaslighting me. And so when he said, oh, it's just, you know, he had said so many flippant things like, well, I guess if you spend your day reading Salon all day, and just things like that, where it was clear that he was trying to get under my skin. And there were points where I laughed because I was just like, what, this is a television show. In the sense that it's not news reporting, it's a sitcom, and it's with one character. As further evidenced by the fact that they kept replaying my episode And I would only find this out because I would be getting hate mail in increased numbers. So the point came where I had been there. One, not she changed his mind. It's Tucker Carlson. We do know some things about him. He's gotten increasingly nationalistic. I mean, praising domestic terrorists like Rittenhouse and just kind of being even more fervent in his awfulness. When I was on, he was a little bit more committed to that pseudo decorum, that civil white supremacy, which is oxymoron. And so I got to the point where he was just dismissing and dismissing and dismissing. And I was so confident. I was like, I have my message triangle. It's what they teach you in comms 101. I've been teaching that all across the country. My main point is that instead of spending money on this counterterrorism effort that just further radicalizes people, further marginalizes folks, why don't we spend that money on mental health care and on actual things that we know can integrate people into society and prevent from, you know, things like radicalization. And also, how about we look at all the radicalization, like the white supremacist radicalization. But as we've seen with the confirmation of Amy Coney Barrett that's going on, America only cares about theocracy. Or only fears theocracy when it's non-Christian. So I wanted to cover all these things. And then it became very apparent that, no, this is just punchline, punchline, punchline. And he had said, I was giving my examples in the middle of my sentence, and he had said, well, you're not here to speak on behalf of those communities. And I was giving illustrated, you know, conversations around not just the Muslim community, but the Black community, the LGBTQ community. And I guess he had assumed visually, this is a Muslim. And that is a one-dimensional thing. You can't be Muslim in other things. That's not allowed. Who did my book or book? So I said, well, actually, in full Scorpio fashion, in addition to being a, you know, I can't remember the exact quote, but I ended up coming out on television by saying, I'm a Muslim person and a Black queer woman at the same time. And he was like, which was iconic, right? We love, you know, shutting down bullies on air. But also it was fun because my partner, Akeem, who's now my fiance, was on set with me and in the corner is just going, whoo, yeah, as quiet as possible. And it was really all topped off by me saying at the end, well, first and foremost, we're all Americans first, aren't we? And I said, I'm Black first. And he was like, end of conversation. And that's really how I shut it down. I had met Ann Coulter that day. She was on set. It was just a very bizarre experience. I had also prayed Salat while I was on the Fox News lot, and nobody had anything to say because it's very duplicitous. Yes, they believe these awful things, but they play characters. You know, Ann Coulter was sitting there in the dressing room with myself and my partner and was just having a nice conversation and then proceeded to use my clip to start to incite, you know, Islamophobic violence. And I quickly realized, oh, this isn't just a fun victory lap where I shut down Tucker Carlson. No, this is a calculated effort to get a young Muslim person who isn't going to be as cautious, perhaps, and I wasn't, as perhaps another person. And also, I hadn't realized that a lot of folks, particularly Arab Muslims who make the circulation on speaking, had been boycotting Fox News. I didn't know that because I was recently a public figure and I wasn't invited to those conversations. And so I got multiple types of backlash. One from homophobic people, generally, did not care what religion I was, who were mad. From homophobic Muslims who were like, what the heck? From really pro-queer folks who were secular, who were like, ahaha, now tell us about how bad Islam is, which was like, okay, what? It was just a variety. And then I also got frustration from other Muslim public figures who were mad that I wasn't playing the game as they were playing, but they didn't provide me the rules. At the same time, I'm being alienated from all those different types of community I have, entering into different communities like the queer community, which is embracing me, and GLAAD was so instrumental in you know, really embracing me. But at the same time, I was denied my security system, my support system. My support system had been so solid, but once they found out something new about me, that had flipped. And it really put me in a vulnerable situation. I got lots of threats. I had to actually move my apartment. I got a lot of backlash and violence. And it put me in positions where I had to seek law enforcement help because we do not have community infrastructure as it stands right now to counter things like getting death threats from a Tor browser. And yet I was villainized again for being transparent about that experience. And so it became a moment for me in my career of, yeah, this is great, I'm getting more visibility, but oh my gosh, I'm getting more visibility, this is bad. Simultaneously having to figure yourself out while being in the public spotlight. And so I think that I'm better for it. You can't go backward in time, but maybe in another dimension, there's a more at peace version of me who potentially is still rather closeted, because I will tell you, you know, I had never anticipated I would be somebody who is as out and proud as I am today. And I don't know, would I ever come out? And it was very convenient to come out that way because, you know, everybody from my aunties to, you know, random people in wherever knew I was queer at the same time, which was, you know, better than Twitter. But simultaneously, it really shifted my understanding of myself, and it made me have to determine who am I, both in the conversation of the larger social media public sphere, and do I even want those things that I've been socialized to seek out?
Thank you for that. The next question is, in your book, Modern Her Story, you celebrate 70 women and non-binary people from underrepresented groups who have changed our world. Your book, Making Our Way Home, examines a great migration, a highly important but often neglected period in Black American history. What was your motivation for writing these books, and how has your work as a historical author shaped your understanding of your own self?
So I love telling this this little tidbit at academic, in academic context, because I don't know how to use commas. Haven't grasped it, working on it, have lots of books on punctuation, but there are folks who have spent their whole careers on editing, so it's okay. And also, I didn't learn how to read really well until third grade, and I still struggle with subject verb agreement. And I think those things are important to name and to say, because I think there's this perception, particularly when you come from an academic context, that once you finish enough degrees, that you will be, you know, peerless and good enough to do all the things that you want to do. But the reality is, there are people who have more access than you, that are less talented than you, that are getting the things that you want, not because they've earned them, but because they have privilege and access. And so it really makes you question, what is the rubric through which we're measuring ourselves if it's already biased, and if it already says things like, you should be a historian. So that's been very interesting for me, because when you write a book and you see people who you share space with ending up on the New York Times bestseller list, when you see folks getting the ability to write these op-eds and, you know, move in these ways, it becomes more about who has the access and the networks and who fits the particular conversation than, did this person sell more books than you, or did this group of editors just prefer this person's book? And so that's really shifted my understanding, again, because it's not about, you know, how many things am I getting? How much clout have I gotten? It's about, why am I doing this work and what's the intention of the work? And so luckily I was able to have conversations with people like Feminisha Jones prior to even publishing, where I didn't have to have that cognitive dissonance around, you know, am I doing a good job? And really figuring out how you're defining that. Because if you're basing your, you know, work on, you know, there's a tweet that went out viral recently, you know, somebody had posted their beautiful illustrations and they said their art teacher didn't like it. Okay, but the art teacher's job is not to like it. The art teacher's job is to say, how is the perspective? What is the contrast looking like? What is the color theory coming up with? And that's really the focus. And so if you're basing your worth and your talents on a rubric created by somebody who doesn't even understand you, you're gonna end up feeling very empty and feeling like you haven't gotten what you feel that you've accomplished. And so no, once I got published, it didn't completely make me a whole complete person, still dealing with everything, still don't know how to use commas, that's fine. But I think it's important to say, because in society, we're socialized to put people on a pedestal depending on how much access they've gained. For Modern History, I did not anticipate being an author and this being my career field. I thought I would do journalism. I wanted to be a lobbyist for a long time, but not for like horrible things. And actually my first job was being a lobbyist, working with a lobbyist at Heineken in government relations. And so I'm sober now, I don't drink. But it's just interesting how my life trajectory was kind of shifting based on, okay, well, I thought I wanted this, but it's not what I thought it was. Let's shift gears and remain open to opportunities. With Making Our Way Home in Modern History, we were going to self-fund, we being myself and Monique Lay, the illustrator. And we had been riding this wave of interest in women's stories and, you know, non-men's stories about and around the women's march, around, you know, the election of Donald Trump, and kind of this simultaneous feeling of guilt that was creating more opportunities for people, and then the recognition that, oh, snap, look at all these people that are talented, but I have been socialized to believe are not talented, but are. And so when those kind of things coalesced, we had fundraised on iFundWomen, an amazing platform if you're looking just shout out iFundWomen, they're great. But by the time we had finished creating the book, we had run out of money. And as you know, with crowdfunding campaigns, you have rewards to fulfill. And with a crowdfunding campaign to do a book, we were very concerned it was going to end up to be Fyre Festival, which hadn't happened yet, but it's a great illusion. You know, I wanted to make sure that I was giving folks the gourmet, not the Wonder Bread with some cheese slices on it. So I was stressed out. I was thinking, what am I gonna do? But like we see with social media, it can be a door that opens up so many opportunities. So I went on Twitter in the most desperation, y'all, as I was sitting on this couch right over here. And I said, okay, Twitter, book's almost done. We don't have a publisher yet. Twitter, do your thing. And LeVar Burton, of Reading Rainbow fame, of Star Trek fame, of, you know, he was Kunta Kinte in Roots, retweeted it. They said, someone published this woman's book to 2 million people, a lot of whom care about reading and literacy and publishing. And so it was really a moonshot, and he actually did the blurb on the back of my book. And it was really just so wild. At the same time, I had not fully understood the publishing realm. Just because you're interested in writing a book doesn't mean that you suddenly have all the knowledge. And so people were reaching out to me in my DMs, over email, everything. So you have to make sure that you're accessible if you're trying to get something done. And people were saying, we'd love to see your book proposal. Can we speak to your book agent? And I was like, oh, absolutely. Please just give us to the end of the week. We will get back to you as soon as humanly possible. Oh, sorry, I'm having issues with my mic. Let me move things over. One second. Come on, tech skills.
Hopefully that's better. Okay, so sorry, it's because I have my earphone and the hijab is just like, what's up? So anyway, and of course my fan just came on. So inshallah, you can hear me. So I was really just trying to capture all the interest and make sure that I could get in touch with these people and connect and make it happen. At the same time, in truth, y'all, I did not know what a book proposal was. I did not know that book agent was a job. You know, I just really felt, because of social media largely, that these things just kind of happen. And what's frustrating to me is when we learn about, you know, people who we view as iconic, but it's made to seem as though this person, you know, like Angela Davis was born as Angela Davis and was on a trajectory anointed by God to do amazing things, which, yes, valid 100%. At the same time, what went into that work? And why are we not all anointed by God to do great things? Why is this essentialism created? And I use Angela Davis as an example because a lot of her work has been around deconstructing that. You know, I have her book right here, Freedom is a Constant Struggle. And she makes sure to make clear that this is something that we have work to do. You don't just become hopeful. Hope is work. This is work that needs to get done. So I wanted to include that story in modern history. At the same time, it was women, again, like Feminista Jones, who literally gave me her number, had just known me from Twitter, and allowed me to call her at her place of work, and she walked me through how to make a book proposal. My friend from Planned Parenthood, their roommate was a book agent. And it really came together in this really beautiful way. I got 17 rejections before the book even happened from people who said things like, I don't think Missy Elliott is a feminist icon. Why aren't there as many white women in your book? Why are there so many black women in your book? Why are you writing this book? You don't look like an author to me. Stuff like that. And I'm like, yeah, I know, but that's because of gatekeepers like you. And so my final meeting was with Caitlin Ketchum at 10 Speed Press. And she said, well, what makes your book unique? And I said, well, you know, there's been a couple books written about women and they kind of lack context as far as, you know, work that needs to get done. And most of them, if not all of them to this point, are written by white women and yet claim to center black women. So what's that about? I said it a lot more aggressive than that. Not necessarily aggressive, but pointed for sure. And I definitely thought that was the last time I was going to have a meeting with her. But instead of, you know, leaning into this fragility, she really listened to me and is the editor not only of this book, but of Making Our Way Home as well. And so my motivation, even in writing it, of course, is to tell stories, but to also to deconstruct the mythology of what it means to be an author. Because not everybody goes to Martha's Vineyard wearing linen, you know, for 6 months to 6 years and writes a book, their first book ends up on the New York Times, and that's the measure of success. No. I want to take the information that has been denied to people who need it the most and also make sure that the people who life is happening to are able to chronicle it. And so that means going through oral histories and going into academia and into these archival spaces and taking that information out and making it accessible. Because your basic textbook in college can cost upwards of $400. It can cost upward of $100. My book costs $20 and is written at a fifth grade level. And most people read at a fifth grade level because we spend so much money on war instead of education. But I wanted to make sure I was meeting that mark so that way we can inform people so we can start to shift tides and start to invest in education so that more education is accessible. But my whole point in trying to be an author, particularly a historical author, is to democratize education and to democratize history. Because when Suetonius, one of the first historians, was writing history, he was writing it for the people. And he didn't have a PhD because those weren't invented yet.
Thank you so much for that expansive and demystifying of the process. And you know, these are really unique books that make a big difference. And I also really love the theme that you have going through about helping one another and who is there as a kind of model, which I think is also part of the text. And shout out to LeVar Burton, who also helped me with my republication of James Baldwin's book. So he's
amazing. He's really amazing. Like, talk about somebody who, like, in a time when so many of our, like, the people we look up to are deeply problematic and have been hiding elements of themselves, it's just so comforting to see people who continue to do the work well, and to use their access, not to shut doors, but to open them.
Yeah, I think that really explains your work and your ethic, too. I want to shift a little bit and talk about your very famous viral TED Talk, Queer and Muslim, Nothing to Reconcile, and I love the title, where you talk about the assumption that queer and Muslim is somehow contradictory or nonsensical. And as a Black woman who converted to Islam in 2015 and came out as bisexual 2 years later, how has your understanding of intersectionality evolved over time? What would you say to younger queer Muslims who may feel alienated and conflicted about their identities?
That's a really great question. I thank you so much for posing it that way. I think, well, let me first start with how my understanding of intersectionality has shifted. I mean, who here, let's be honest with ourselves, thought that intersectionality was just naming the identities you have? Because that's how it's talked about in most contexts. Luckily, we're starting to shift that. And I speak so often, the groups that I speak with most often are like middle grades, and so a lot of folks, they're like Gen Z, they love TikTok. I mean, I'm pretty sure that's y'all's generation somewhat too, but younger folks, and I tell them, like, now if you know intersectionality but you don't know Kimberly Crenshaw, that's like knowing Old Town Road but not knowing Lil Nas X. And they're like, oh my gosh, but how could you know Old Town Road and not know the icon Lil Nas X? And I'm like, exactly, how could you not know Dr. Kimberly Crenshaw? But because of academia and the way it's mystified, it's made to seem as though, oh, you'll never understand that, it's not worth understanding, here's just a filtered down version of it. And that just doesn't happen with academia, that happens with religious texts as well. So brief definition of intersectionality, as I've come to understand it, it is the identities we inhabit, but also as they relate to systems of privilege and oppression. And it was first created specifically to capture what Black women encounter in the workplace, because Dr. Kimberly Crenshaw is a legal scholar, so we have to understand it's from that basis. I tell people that, and they're like, well, actually, it's not just about Black women. And I'm like, actually, that was the original framework, and if you don't understand that, that is a failure of intersectionality. And so when I, you know, understand who I am, thanks to the theory of intersectionality and the work done by Dr. Kimberly Crenshaw, I'm able to understand that I can't bifurcate part of who I am. I can't say, oh, hey, you know, Muslim Student Union, love to come and talk as a Muslim, and then I somehow like leave the rest of who I am at home and, you know, just duplicate that over the other identities I hold. But also the fact that when people say things like, the Muslim community needs to stand up for LGBTQ people, you're immediately erasing LGBTQ Muslims who exist as a matter of statistics, because queer people are born everywhere. We are as naturally occurring as the rainbow that represents us. Yet it's made to seem as though intentionally by various institutions, whether those are capitalistic institutions or whatever, or religious institutions, that queer people are new and have to be reconciled into the context of ancient texts. When instead, it's the fact that the categorization of gender, the categorization of sexual orientation, the categorization of gender expression, those are new things, but they have always been. And the language that we use to discuss them, that is what is new. And also, the bias against us, that is what is new. Because at one point, there was, and this happens over, like, you know, a very simplistic version of this, but there comes a time when it becomes either profitable or necessary to sustain systems like colonization or capitalism to other a group of people. In this case, we can talk about gender. We can talk about the erasure of people who are non-binary or who are outside of male-female gender context, or the fact that if we even look at the karyotype pairings, and I talked about this on Smarter in Seconds, of what results in what we understand as biological sex, it's not just two, it's eight. And I covered the six most common ones on my Smarter in Seconds series. So it's interesting because what you have is people existing systems being created by those people. Those systems then putting those people down and saying, oh, this group of people, they don't exist. And if you think they exist, you're a bad person. And then science saying, actually, these people exist. And it's so frustrating because you have every layer of those being at odds with one another. And it's not new, but I think what's good for me to understand and what's clarifying for me to understand is that it's intentional. You know, if you tell somebody that their self-worth is a matter of their own mind, and it might be, it could be chemical, right? But it could also be, and likely is, the layers of socialization that we've had that says, oh, well, you know, if somebody who is a white, cisgender, straight man says, oh, I'm great, that's fine, because of course he's great. But if I say that I'm great, I am hubristic. I'm being immodest. When modesty and self-worth are not in conflict with one another. But all these things are very intentional. And so I think once we lay that all out, it becomes very clear. And that's what I try to do in my TED Talk. The frustrating thing with the TED Talk was that I had such little time to rehearse. It was probably one of the few speeches I've written down. I enjoy doing extemporaneous speech. I think that there's just different ways to prepare for the work that you do. And so there were elements that I wanted to include. And one of the things that I included just kind of as a gotcha for people who I knew would have different biases, was that I talked about how I used to work at Heineken. Well, I continue to talk about how I'm a queer Muslim. And if you are a adherent Muslim, as we understand folks, you would have an issue with all of those things, would you not? But it's the way that sin and forbiddenness or haramness are ranked by human bias, not actually by God. Or the understanding that I have, which is that, you know, stories in the Quran, which are interpreted by human beings to be queerphobic, to be, you know, homophobic and transphobic, are interpreted as such to serve a human agenda. And this idea that Islam is perfect, but Muslims are not. And that's the whole conversation. And I further break it down just briefly because I love inserting Pokemon into my keynote speeches. If we all watch the same episode of Pokemon, we're all going to have a different interpretation of it. Take that OG episode of Pokemon where Charmander is sitting there with his flame. We could all write essays about what that flame means and the conversation about abuse. And are there bad Pokemon or are there bad trainers? Like these things that have no bearing on our eternal souls, unless there's a church of Pokemon. In my case, I apologize. But if we understand these levels of our investment in our version of the truth being the truth, and we apply that to our two basic things like Star Trek, like Star Wars, like Pokemon, and we see how fandoms deal with that, we see somebody who's black do a cosplay of Luke Skywalker. You can't do that. Luke Skywalker is white. Luke Skywalker doesn't exist, bro. Let me do what I want to do. Muslims don't exist in Star Trek. Star Trek isn't real, bro, you know? And if it was, here's all the reasons why this is valid. And so what I like to do is to make people understand that. Oh yeah, no, I totally have an understanding of how high stakes conversations about, you know, fandom get. Well, if we understand religion to be a hyper version of fandom, which it is, we have lore, we have theology and pathology, then it makes very much sense why there's so many different sects. And then we also apply that on having a bearing on our eternal souls. Yes, there's going to be laws that are passed to prevent people from being their full selves because human beings are always invested in our version of the truth being true. And so it's hard to make that connection to somebody who is very furiously intent on not having, you know, queer or trans folks at their mosque, but I think it can at least give us a peace of mind in our sense that, hey, no scholar is above another person. You know, the first converts to Islam had not read the Quran. They were illiterate. You know, these things that were facts of life, the fact that in the Quran, there are surahs that talk about people who are illiterate being as close to God as a king, if not closer, because they understand so many other things that a king and their privilege doesn't give them access to or denies them access from. And so that's what helps me find my peace of mind, because it makes me understand there's nothing wrong with me. I'm not being bullied. I'm not being harassed because I'm LGBTQ. It's because I live in a homophobic world.
Wow. I mean, like, thank you so much for breaking that down and not only shining the spotlight on, you know, Dr. Kimberly Crenshaw, but also speaking to the how frustrating it is for our identities to be, you know, continually simplified, flattened, and erased. You know, we shouldn't have to, I guess, justify ourselves. But to kind of shift, so the next kind of question is, so that the New York Times Magazine 1619 Project, it boldly reexamines the legacy of slavery in American cultural memory, and it centers the contributions of Black Americans to this nation's history. Many conservatives have criticized this project as propaganda, while other political figures like, you know, Senator Kamala Harris have praised it. As a Black historian, what was your initial reaction to the 1619 Project? And why do you think so many are hostile to historical work that centers Black people?
White supremacy is ubiquitous in American culture, and it thrives on misinformation and on it being hidden. And once we start to uncover it, it threatens white supremacy. And that's how you have people saying things like the president that, you know, racial bias trainings are bad because it teaches people to hate America. If I teach you about America and you decide you're not super for America or that America needs to do better, that's not about how I'm teaching. That's about America. And so I think the 1619 Project does that similarly. And any text that really focuses on Black folks as the center of the story. I mean, you have the debacle that went on with the creation of the Blacksonian, as I call it, or the National Museum of African American History and Culture. Blacksonian, I think, works aptly, because it's a Black Smithsonian. But if you look at how much argument went into the creation of that museum, and that even with it being created, and it's still paying homage to figures in American history that are white, that are, you know, praised as the magnum opus of American history and what we should aspire to be, such as Abraham Lincoln, such as FDR, both of whom were white supremacists, it becomes increasingly difficult. And so, it's just funny to me because, of course a project like the 1619 Project is going to ruffle feathers, is going to make people who want to believe in white supremacy and how it connects to American exceptionalism, it's going to piss them off. Because it counters that. It presents evidence to the contrary. You know, when I was talking about my book, Making Our Way Home, and I was on my book tour briefly at the beginning of the year, I sat next to someone on a plane who actually had gone to school with Sylvia Plath, which was cool. And she was talking about how, I don't understand why they won't just let her be queer. Or she didn't say queer. She's like, she was a gay. You know, everybody was gay. It was fine. It was just great. That's just an aside. But so I was talking to her. She's a pretty liberal woman, as you can tell. And I was talking to her about redlining and how I covered that in my book. And she said, what was that? Mind you, she's an older woman. She benefited from redlining. And yet, the way that history is taught, and because of segregation, because the way certain stories are hidden, she did not even know what happened. And so folks like her are led to believe that when they see Black folks living in lower income areas, high crime areas, that they are high crime because Black people love committing crimes and not because we're over-policed. And of course, they will be able to detect more crimes in a place where there's more police, but that people commit crimes across the board because we're all human. And if you create systems of scarcity, people will want to survive by any means necessary. And then you criminalize that survival. And so if you don't learn any of those things, it's like not learning that Black queer veterans were denied, you know, access to veteran benefits, that queer people have been erased from history. If you, the first time you learn about queer folks is during the Stonewall riots, then you're gonna say to yourself, why are these folks so mad? Where do they even come from? And so these things are so important to build upon each other. When I talk about in my book, Baking Our Way Home, I make sure that people understand things like the GI Bill, like blue discharge papers, like redlining, and how all of these things came together that resulted in the civil rights movement. There were so many people having kids. Baby boomers are not just white. Black folks, Latino folks, indigenous folks were having kids at high rates as well. And they wanted those kids to be able to access the American dream. And so of course the civil rights movement happened as a natural continuation. It wasn't just, as history is often told, that enslavement occurred, disappeared after Lincoln signed a piece of paper, which immediately freed everyone. Then Black people disappear for decades and then show up with Dr. King with anger and righteous indignation. That's not how it goes, but that is how it's told. And so when you have works of media, works of history like the 1619 Project, like Isabel Wilkerson's text, like, you know, Henry Louis Gates' work, like even fictionalized works like, what was it called? Like Watchmen. People are going to be frustrated because it says, hey, American narrative, you spent so much time caring about the Dust Bowl farmers, but did you know that was at the same time that 40% of farm workers were Black? And yet they are erased not only from the historical memory, but they were erased from being able to access benefits and were dealing with lynching. That frustrates people because it takes what they hold sacred and says, put that into perspective and understand that not only did this have not a huge bearing on the story of America, but look at all these people who had it worse that were doing things as well. and American exceptionalism. I mean, the whole idea that we're number one, regardless of what the facts show. We're number one in education. Actually, we're doing extremely poorly. The only thing we're number in one, we might still be, is cases of coronavirus, which also came from American exceptionalism. The thing that we can't get affected by a virus, we're great. We're still people. And so all these things kind of coalesce. But I think that if you are doing work and you intend to disrupt the status quo, you can't be shocked when you do. And it's just figuring out how to measure that, how to put that into context, and how to protect yourself. Because you do want to remain protected, you want to be able to thrive in the world that we're trying to create together. But it's also this idea of divine speech, that sometimes the words and the work that we're doing is more important than anything else. And it shouldn't be that way, but often it is. And there's just many ways that that can iterate upon itself. But I think that it's good that it's happening. How exciting that we're living in a time where we have the democratization of information to where you can just pull up a screen and learn about a sector of history that has been yet untold, not because it wasn't worth telling, but because systems prevented it from being told. I think that's deeply exciting.
Thank you so much for that answer. And I think this is going to be the last question before we transition into the Q&A portion. But you've amassed an impressive social media platform, which I'd like to say I've been a huge fan of for a few years.
I know. Just so y'all know, she's an OG. I almost came with my rainbow eyeshadow because she has an amazing makeup page. But you've seen firsthand how I kind of was building up my social media following. And then June 1st, when everybody realized racism was real, I woke up to 100,000 more followers. Do you know how many times I rubbed my eyes, put eye drops in, try to make sure that this was really what I was seeing? Anyway, sorry, finish the question. I was just like...
No, thank you. So you've used your social media platform to increase awareness about injustice in Black, queer, Muslim communities. But what do you think the biggest steps are that we as students can take to overcome issues like sexism, queer and transphobia, anti-Blackness, or Islamophobia in our communities? And what advice would you give to college students who are interested in becoming better advocates?
Ooh, good questions. First, I want to say, let me also use this opportunity to talk about an issue that's happening right now. There's a practice called SARS. It's a version of police brutality that's happening in Nigeria. So, you know, anti-Blackness is global, so is, as it connects to poverty in the global Black diaspora, even within governments that are majority Black. So please educate yourself about it, and SARS is the hashtag, so please do that. I think that the most important thing that we can do to be more justice-minded and liberation-minded and to take action in those veins is to realize that what we're up against is intentional. America wasn't racist on accident. Redlining didn't happen on accident, yet that's so often how it's discussed. I mean, if we look at things like the Tuskegee syphilis atrocity, not even calling it an experiment, because it wasn't that, oh snap, it didn't go the way we wanted. It was literally engineered during a financial crisis with the intention to not treat people for tertiary syphilis, which results in death. And so if we learn it as, oh, it was just a bunch of plucky, smart scientists and everything went awry and oh no, but those farmers should have known better to get themselves trapped up in that, it makes it seem as though America is just a well-meaning, plucky young country that doesn't have deep-seated roots in capitalism, colonization, theft of land, genocide, and enslavement. But that's not true. It is what it is, and we have to understand that. And once you're equipped with that knowledge, it becomes a lot easier to navigate through it. Oh no, I'm not shocked that the president didn't condemn white supremacists. He's a white supremacist. Duh. And it becomes easier to take action after that. But if we're constantly being caught unawares, yeah, it's okay to be shocked and surprised. Not gonna, you know, shut down anybody's emotions. But it's important to put that into context and to prepare ourselves. Because if you stay ready, you don't have to get ready. So that's the first thing. Another thing that I try to practice on a daily basis is learning in public. You know, I don't know all the things, even though I'm an educator. And I think it's important to continually say that. The best teachers I had growing up from elementary school to college were the ones where I would ask a question, say they didn't know the answer. They would tell me that they didn't know and that, you know, why don't you go home and check it out and I'll go home and check it out and we'll come back and we'll have a discussion. That's a lot richer than feeling bad for asking a question that wasn't, you know, on topic. And so do that on social media as well. I think that now that I'm this big time influencer, I'm trying to get to like 300K by the end of the month, which is wild because I have 50K at the beginning of the year. Again, because so many people realize that it's worth listening to conversations around race, privilege, and oppression, which is fantastic. It's about letting folks know that you're willing to learn. I did a post recently and I talked about anti-Semitism and I had hyphenated anti-Semitism. Turns out it's one word and that hyphenating it actually reinforces anti-Jewish ideology and this idea that Semitic describes the people when it's more appropriate to use that to describe language, and that using it to describe people makes it seem as though there's a conspiracy, which again is rooted in anti-Semitic ideology. So I did a Smarter in Seconds on that after consulting with several folks who educate specifically around anti-Jewish oppression and looking at the ways that I could use my platform not to feel like, oh snap, I'm never going to talk about this again. Who does that serve? No one. But to say, let me be a better advocate and help to make the world safer for our Jewish siblings. Because if I treat the work around anti-Semitism the same way folks who feel a little bit immobilized by the work around racism, then how can I then get frustrated at folks who don't speak up about racism because they're afraid of how it will look if I'm doing the same thing around a different group, you know, and just continue to apply that. And so I not only just changed it to make it look like I learned it overnight, I made sure people understood that I didn't know before and that now I'm doing better, I want you to do better too. And I feel like it's a much richer way to experience the world because now people don't come at me to cancel me over stuff. They know that I'm willing to listen. And I think that treating not only information as something that's not absolute makes me a better educator too. Because when I write captions, I'm not assuming people know things. And I don't do things like say, and for those who don't know, which takes up precious character counts, I just explain what the new thing is. And I think that makes it much more compassionate because if you're constantly going to in a workspace, well, for those who didn't do the reading, instead, maybe the teacher should understand that there's a pandemic going on and that it was a super long reading and maybe I got a couple minutes of it in, but after a while, I needed to take a break. And also, did you watch the debate last night? Anyway, the teacher could instead say, here's the key points from the reading. Who wants to speak up on this section? Who wants to speak up on this section? Because if we treat education as something that is absolute, that exists, and that those who aren't in the know are lesser than, we're not doing our job as educators. And we're not doing our job as people who are justice-minded. And so I encourage folks, you know, you all are at an institution like Stanford, an institution with amazing access. You know, I don't even feel like I was confident enough in my own academic abilities to apply to the school that I'm not speaking at. But it's important for you all to carry that with you. You will have access to things that other folks might not have access to. It doesn't make you better than those folks, but it does give you an extra responsibility to make sure that the information you're learning is also accessible to folks who don't have that same access, folks back home, folks who are not as close to in proximity to academic education. And so that's what I try to do. I've had the power and ability to get my books published, but I'm not stopping it there. I'm constantly making sure that other folks are doing that work. So instead of looking at ourselves as exceptions to the rule, look at ourselves as responsible for making sure that we aren't the exception, that we're not just the first or not just the only, but to make sure that being the first doesn't stop us from doing other work and doesn't stop us from making sure that there's 20 people who are also going to be in here next time.
That's really fabulous. I think with the question of education and getting more voices in, maybe we're going to just open it up to anyone who has questions from the audience. And we have so much more to say as well, but I'm learning from you as you're speaking as well. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you so much for reminding this amazing just presentation and speech. I'm learning so much. I mean, just like everything that you're saying is just like shocking me. I'm like, oh my God, yes. Like I need to learn that. I mean, I'm just thinking like something that I thought too was like how you're, I guess, a little more educated than me in some aspects, but that also tells me like, okay, I need to read that. Like I need to like inform myself about that.
And you know, so. The other thing too though, is that I wasn't always just knowing all this stuff. Like I was about to say on Twitter last night that at some point, the thing that you know that you're so proud of yourself for knowing, you didn't know that. And like, it's not that I'm more educated than you. I might be educated about different stuff than you, but we're all experts on something. And sometimes that thing is just our own lived experience. And so really when you come into spaces, I think that even as myself as an educator, when I come to these, I'm not thinking, oh, I'm here to educate and not learn anything from anybody else, but also to think of yourself as that role as well. I'm not just here to receive, I'm here to share as well. And I think that makes it a little bit more encouraging when you wanna give input and ask questions, audience, so that way you can feel like you're participating, not just to learn, but maybe to share something new with me as well.
Yeah, thank you so much. So I just wanted to open it up to all the panelists first. If they have any questions, just like go ahead and unmute yourself and ask. And if not, then I can start reading from the Q&A. I don't know. I'll just give like...
There's a really good Q&A question.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, we can just go ahead and start with that. So I guess I can read it off for everyone. Social media is a powerful tool for organizing, but due to its capitalistic motivations, it is also a tool for spreading conspiracies, hatred, and misinformation. What's the ideal role of social media in society, and how do we make sure that social media platforms remain useful tools for justice without being weapons of injustice?
So thank you so much for this question, Noah. I love notifications, so when I saw it in the thing, I was like, let me click on it. That's also why I respond to all my DMs on Instagram, because that's how it's created. And so I think, you know, there's actually just a recent documentary that came out called The Social Dilemma, and I actually was able to work with Netflix to give some like feedback on it. It's on YouTube if you want to see my opinions and thoughts. And I'm like the newest influencer of the group that we had, folks who have been doing this since Instagram started. And the thing I try to tell to companies, because I often consult with companies, like if I'm reporting the same thing, especially on Twitter after Tucker Carlson, I was reporting things and I was getting like things that were maybe specific to the Muslim community that were homophobic. Somebody who doesn't have that experience isn't going to then, when I flag it, report it. And the algorithm that person creates isn't going to capture that that's rude. If somebody says I'm a harami, that's not being captured by somebody who has a Christian understanding of things and only is used to the word sinner. So I decided to take a step further and try to get my foot in the door and meet with these companies. That often means that you're not always gonna get paid, which sucks, but I'm thinking about this as an extension of my organizing work. And luckily now I'm able to consult with companies. But the way I try to explain it is that the way that platforms, I would recommend that y'all look up section 230 in Congress. It's about how tech companies are viewed. And so if you have Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, that's used as an internet service provider, which means that, you know, if you download something from your, you know, computer, the router company like Spectrum isn't going to be charged with what you do with it. But Twitter is treated the same way, which makes zero sense, because if somebody is on Twitter and inciting folks to violence and Twitter doesn't take it down, shouldn't Twitter be a little responsible? Yes, completely. And so that's starting to shift, which is why now when you talk about voting or you talk about COVID, there's information bars that show up. That's because Instagram is trying to get its shit together to make sure that when Congress passes this law, which is going, it's impending, it's a conversation that's happening right now, that they don't have to suddenly retroactively fix things. But it's constantly shifting, and that's why there's so many rule changes. And I think it's positive. We can't just look at ourselves like, you know, say you own a parking lot. Well, a fight's gonna happen at that parking lot. Oh, but you just own the place. No, you own the place and you have the ability to block it off, to tell people to get off your property and to disperse, and you don't do that and somebody dies in that fight, you're gonna be held responsible. But the way that social media platforms have been treating it is as if, oh no, I'm just neutral. This is just land that I have complete control over and I can't do anything about changing it. And that was created for capitalistic intentions. The way that social media apps are being treated as internet service providers made sense maybe 10 years ago or 15 years ago when they were newer and we wanted to, you know, spur growth. But what's the point of creating something for it to get totally bad and then for us to have to fix it when we could do better from the jump? And so I'm really excited now that I'm having conversations with different social media companies about how they can make stuff work well from the jump. Like the fact that, you know, niqabis, women who cover their, you know, everything but their eyes, it's called niqab. I wear a hijab, it's different, but it's still kind of connected in the realm of modesty. A lot of women who cover, and not just women, folks from different genders as well, were raising the alarm around face IDs. This doesn't work for me because I don't show my face and I shouldn't have to show my face. Well, guess what? Those social media companies are not realizing that people are wearing masks and maybe they should have had multiple settings for it to just capture your eyes, and they could have listened to the niqabis way back when and not had to create new things. And so, I want to leave you all with this little, like, before we do more questions, and I'm happy to go a little bit over time. Let me give you this example that I wrote for some folks that weren't really getting it. Okay, story time, Blair. In a faraway land, there's a castle and farms and a dragon. If you follow me on Twitter, you've already seen this. And there's a dragon that lives in the cave. And every couple months, the dragon comes out of its cave and eats all the villagers' sheep. And it's terrible because that's how they make their livelihood. Well, after it was almost a full moon again, and the dragon was going to come out of its cave, and the people go to the king and say, please, king, please, let us put our sheep away or get rid of the dragon or do something that can protect us. And the king says, that's radical. That's ridiculous. Why would you do that? All of our sheep have been killed. We can get more sheep. Don't worry about it. Well, the king goes and passes laws to prevent the people from being able to, you know, get the dragon or protect their sheep. But some villagers go against the grain and put their sheep away that night. Well, guess what? None of the villagers' sheep were out for the dragon to eat them. So the dragon went over the villagers' houses and ate all of the king's sheep. And the king said, how could this have happened? Why didn't we stop this? The end. And that's basically what social media apps are doing right now. They've been warned, they've been put on notice, but they keep acting like there's no issue. And so it's past time, not only in the context of organizing outside of the online realm, but also in the online realm, to look at the motivations for creating a status quo and look at how that status quo is being harmful, not only when it's the most violent consequences, like with Rittenhouse, but when it's everyday harassment. And I hope that social media apps are getting more attuned to it, but there's a lot of work to get done.
Thank you so much for that response. Any questions? Please, everyone, ask away. Okay, cool. We just got a question. I can read it out loud. So as young adults, are learning and educating ourselves while on this journey of growth and discovery, I personally have struggled with communicating effectively with people who disagree, particularly with family members like my parents. And I feel that many also face similar struggles at home. What do you advise in handling these difficult conversations at home? This is from Dwight Hua. Thank you so much for this question.
Thank you so much, Dwight. I experienced this too. I think it's important for folks to know that even for folks who educate about privilege and oppression for a living, they got problematic family members too. And even, you know, I have problematic things I need to work through. And so my mom in particular, she has some, you know, my mom's a white passing Black woman. She grew up in South Central Los Angeles, and she's bilingual, and she's experienced a lot of different layers of, you know, privilege and oppression, as we all have. Well, my mom has held on to a couple racisms, particularly as it deals with driving. And I was in the car with her, and I was like, wait, why am I instructing my followers to have these difficult conversations with their families when I'm, like, letting my mom slide and say racist stuff about other drivers? Like, let me not do that. And so I was trying to break it down with my mom, and y'all, I understand how difficult it is. And I think that the thing that unlocks the door for me is knowing that you're not always going to make their minds change. And if you go into a conversation thinking you're going to change somebody's mind, you are going to get, just inherently, because it's how human psychology works, you're going to get more heated, you're going to feel more passionate. Sometimes that can fuel you into action, but not all of us are versed in being effective communicators while also being, you know, angry or passionate, and validly so. So when you just present information and you start to chip away at that person's mindset, then you start to get results, and that's what I've seen. So my mom said this ridiculous statistic, and I was like, okay, I looked it up. Next time we were driving together, I made sure to bring it up about how, actually, you know, I looked up what you said, and it's completely wrong and racist, you know, and do it in a way where you're meeting their values. And this works kind of across the board. If you go into a situation where I'm just presenting information, it's not to say, and it really depends, you know, say that my mom was then, you know, advocating that we pass laws to put those people down. That's not the time to slowly and you know, patiently chip away at something. If it's an idea that they're espousing, if it's affecting people, if it's an idea they're espousing, that's one thing. If it's affecting people in a material way, that needs a completely different approach. And this is not applying to that. Like, say somebody in your family thinks that a group of people shouldn't exist. Not the time to be patient and start chipping away at that. That's time for serious intervention. And I highly recommend looking at different scholars that focus on that specific issue for an approach. But also to understand that you're not going through it alone. You know, there's layers to it. And also to know that people's hearts and minds can change. When I first converted to Islam, my mom was not about it. My dad was like, cool, whatever. My dad's pretty much a Black Panther hippie. You know, he's 70. My mom, on the other hand, she watches a lot. I make her sound like a terrible person. You can follow her at Chrissy Imani. If you want to see her stuff, she's hilarious. But she was super liberal about most things. I mean, when I came out as queer to her when I was like 15, she made me go to my doctor to get inclusive sex ed, which was mortifying, but necessary because she didn't know how to give me sex ed as somebody who was straight. And so when it came to everything, she was so justice-minded, but then when it came to the issue of hijab and Islam, when we would see people at Disneyland with a hijab, she would say, oh, that poor woman, and always assume that the woman was being put down. Well, flash forward to me converting to Islam and wanting to wear hijab myself, she still had those feelings. And so that's when it becomes a point of, oh man, maybe I could have nipped it in the bud back then, but I was a kid. How could I have known what language to use? So when it presented itself, she was still very frustrated about me wearing hijab because it didn't make sense to her. Well, in Islam, we also want to respect our elders. And so it took me getting to a place of autonomy where she was no longer financially in charge of me, which is a good growth step for me. but also making sure that she couldn't then sweep the rug from underneath me and say, oh, well, now we have this financial power dynamic. And that's when I got my job at Planned Parenthood, my first big girl job, paying my own rent, doing stuff like that, getting on my own healthcare. And it was not until that point where there was this understanding between family that you do not control me, and therefore you have to respect me as an autonomous person, that things could happen. That doesn't always play out that way, especially during a pandemic when so many of us are separated from our support systems and are with our family, that might be problematic. It means understanding that it's completely valid to hide part of yourself, to preserve all of yourself. And that means sometimes going along to get along, even if it's super toxic and harmful, if it makes you safer. But also knowing that there's resources out there if you are in a dangerous situation. So it's extremely nuanced, and there's not a one-size-fit-all solution for it. But sometimes the only thing you can do is control the circumstances in your immediate control and try to do that best, but also not feel bad or fraudulent or like you're letting things happen on your watch if you literally can't do anything about it because of a power dynamic. And that has to be part of every conversation. If you're in an environment where somebody's saying something horrible, even like I was saying before, where they don't want a group of people to exist, and you're secretly part of that group of people, maybe letting that person know puts you in danger. So it's not that you're hiding part of yourself or you're living a lie, it's that you're living to survive, and that is 100% valid, especially when you give the context of your personal safety. So definitely understand what's the dynamics are, but don't feel bad for not being able to solve everything, because we have a long road ahead and we want to be able to live in that world that we're trying to create.
Thank you so much for that amazing answer. Professor Brody has to step out now. She has other responsibilities. Thank you so much, Professor Brody, for that amazing, for moderating so well. And if anyone has any other questions, please feel free to ask away. If not, I think it's important to acknowledge that the election is coming up, and just like any, I don't know, thoughts. I mean, I don't want to ask you like,
I go off. It's fine. Please. So I actually, one of my jobs that I had was being a civic action lead, and my whole job was to like get people to register to vote. And what's so frustrating is that even though I've had that job experience, I'm now facing voter disenfranchisement myself, where because my license is suspended in New York because I could not afford $7,000 a year car insurance, it was super expensive. My license got suspended because my car registration was suspended. And I'm still showing up as registered to vote in New York, and I can't get an ID in California. And I'm trying to use my passport or my social security number to be able to register to vote in California, but it's still not working. And so I wanted to share that because even as somebody who literally teaches about voter disenfranchisement and has a book talking about voter disenfranchisement, I'm still affected by voter disenfranchisement. And I think another thing to talk about when it comes to the election is that the presidency is a white supremacist construct. It is a like neocolonial construct, and we're not going to solve those things through a presidency. And it doesn't mean, it means when I talk about voting, it's not me collapsing all the work that we need to get done into clicking, checking things on a ballot, but part of the conversation. And I get so frustrated when people are like, just vote, because I'm like, hey, if it were that easy, we would all be able to vote. We wouldn't be in this unflushable toilet bowl of a situation we're currently in, would we? And when people say, oh, let's just listen to the most oppressed people. Well, if we did, they wouldn't be the most oppressed people, would they? And so it's so varied. But I really encourage you to make your voice heard, not just, at the top, but down ballot. And also looking at the fact that you can, run for office. You can recommend ballot initiatives. And it's intentionally difficult to understand. Y'all got into Stanford. I believe in you. You could do this. But even if you didn't, because of myself, I educate on it. So it's trying to make others understand, as well as yourselves, that the way that information is released, that is doled out, looking at the confirmation of Amy Coney Barrett, it's made intentionally difficult to understand. So if you can unlock that key for other people, do it. And send it to me and I'll repost it to make sure that we're getting as much information out as possible, because it's made intentionally difficult to understand. So don't feel bogged down if you're not getting it right away. It's intentionally difficult.
Great, thank you so much. And we got another question in the Q&A chat from Osama, who's asking, what do you do for your self-care and for your mental wellness?
Yeah. I think this is my friend from way back. Osama El Gabalawi, if I'm not mistaken. What's up, Osama? If not, otherwise, salams to the other Osama. So for self-care and mental wellness, Right now I'm having a recess beverage, hashtag not sponsored. I have to say that stuff now because I influence, but it's, I'm sober. So I'm an alcoholic, I'm sober. And it was so hard for me as somebody who, he says it's me, he just texted me. What's up, Osama? So it's interesting. I mean, I, as a Muslim, it was hard for me to name the fact that I'm an alcoholic. I am. It's not going to go away regardless of the religion I am, because statistically, I mean, also just like humanly, I will have the same predispositions to addiction that I would regardless of what religion I decide to practice. But the added layer of being a public figure, of, you know, the embarrassment of having, you know, struggling with things like addiction while also feeling like I had to be perfect, made it really hard for me to name those things. And a lot of us go through that, whether that's through school, like, and do I need a mental health day, or am I just being lazy? No, sometimes it's mental health. And also laziness is like so racialized, so ableist. Give yourself a break. There's a pandemic going on. If you can't get that essay done, that's okay. Mashallah to you to being able to conceptualize the essay in the first place. There's so much going on. The first part of the pandemic, I just played Animal Crossing for 500 hours until my savings ran out. And like, you know, it's real. So grasp that, understand that, and give yourself a break for it. And understanding that sometimes mental health and wellness, not sometimes, every time, it happens in a context. If you can't get what you need to be healthy, that's probably on purpose because of the systems that exist, but also how do you navigate those systems? You can't just be better. As far as my drinking and my alcoholism went, I was so convinced I wasn't that bad because the alcoholics in my family were worse off. So don't measure yourself against other people. That's how you lose. You know, you'll be so busy trying to be like, well, at least I'm not like that. At least I'm not like that. Then suddenly you're right there. And so figure out what's healthy for you, because we're all different. All of our mental health is different. What works for somebody might not work for you, probably doesn't work for you. So figure out what is the baseline for you. What is baseline plus pandemic for you? What is baseline plus depression plus anxiety for you? And navigate that way and figure out what makes sense to you. And I had to get to a point with my alcoholism where I didn't care what other folks thought. I did actually lose some friends who were like, well, why did you start drinking in the first place? Which is not how alcoholism works, or addiction. And decide that I actually don't want people in my life who are going to shame me for me getting healthy, because getting healthy, that's the whole point. And so now I do alternatives like Recess is a good one. There's one called Clean Cause, which donates 50% of money to addiction and recovery. And it's just understanding that you need to do what works for you. And be okay with that. And also be okay with people disagreeing with it and knowing that it's not about them. And sometimes it's hard, again, when we look at power dynamics or the family structures that we're in, but that's what it's about. And the other thing I'll say is that when we talk about self-care, we have to talk about Black feminist scholars like Audre Lorde and how self-care was not created as a capitalistic construct. I mean, like right now I'm telling you, like, go buy drinks and stuff, but also maybe look within your own heart and feel and look at what can replace that. For me, I couldn't just switch over to tonic water and stop drinking gin. I also had to do that on like mental work and get healthy that way and completely reframe what, you know, partying looked like for me, what joy looked like for me. So when we talk about self-care, look at it outside the capitalistic construct, because capitalism thrives on people feeling like they're operating at the bare minimum. So start taking your time back. There's something called the nap ministry, which you can follow online. It's about the revolutionary nature of naps, the way that we look down on other cultures, particularly Spanish cultures that take a siesta. That's actually necessary for the human body. You know, being busy, being booked and busy is great. Not if you're empty and not able to fulfill yourself and be whole. And also the idea that self-care, if your self-care is connected to the oppression of somebody else, it's terrible self-care. And so self-care isn't just selfish. It's looking at a broader community framework and figuring out how you can be healthy. That means if you need to get a massage, well, guess what? There's a pandemic and that massage worker doesn't deserve to have to breathe the same air as you, or you to be maskless to get a manicure in order to feel better. Figure out a different way that you're not putting other people in harm. Or, you know, maybe you need to isolate yourself if you can't wear a mask outdoors. Like, just figure out a way where you can be healthy, not at the peril of other people. And I think that's abundantly clear for folks. Like, recently I went to war with somebody on Instagram DM or Instagram comments because they had posted their all white team going on a retreat to Tulum while also voguing, which was just so cringe. And so I was like, this is very privileged. And they said I was shaming them for having a different lifestyle. Well, if your lifestyle is rooted in erasure of Black and queer folks, being reckless on vacation during a pandemic and then posting it about it, then I will absolutely shame that lifestyle, because it's not a lifestyle, it's privilege. And so self-care looks like knowing what makes sense for you, knowing what is nonsense, and then figuring out how you can participate in a healthy and safe way, not by harming others.
Thank you so much for answering that question. We actually wrote a lot of questions for you, so I'm actually looking back at our notes right now.
Wait, I think Antonia has it, if I'm saying your name correctly.
Yes. Hi, I'm Antonia. First of all, thank you so much for coming to speak. This is so wonderful, and
I'm having fun.
Like, just the most wonderful person too, so I really appreciate it. And I'm just curious, when you were our age in college.
How old are y'all? I'm 27.
I'm 21.
Okay, so long ago.
Just college age, who was one of your role models and why?
Okay, Angela Davis, of course. I think for many reasons, though, I could identify with her, like from a visual standpoint. Let me see if I can pull up this. So I actually got to meet her. I took a selfie with her when she and Erica Totten came to speak at Busboys and Poets, actually about this book. And I actually spoke to her. And she gave me like the extra encouragement I need to not go to law school, because it wasn't working for me. What I had understood to be the trajectory that I needed to do was not what worked for me. So here's Angela Davis and me. Like, I show folks this and they're like, is that your grandma? And I'm like, yes, Angela Davis is my grandma. Not really, but I love that. But as I was trying to be Angela Davis, I found myself, because I wasn't trying to be Angela Davis. I was trying to be my version of Angela Davis. And so when I talk to people about role models, maybe you find somebody who you can identify with because they have the same identifiers as you. Maybe they make some decisions that you don't agree with. Well, that's why they're a role model, not a role carbon copy, you know? Not a role 3D printer. Sorry. Yes, mommy, I would love sushi.
Okay.
Do you want to say hi?
Sure. Hi, everyone.
So anyway, I was talking less about you. Anyway.
Of course you did. Yes. Okay.
All right. Sorry, folks. And so in my pursuit of being Angela Davis, I found myself. And so I think that when we look at role models as examples of a trajectory that we admire or of a type of way of understanding, then they don't necessarily have to be the same identity categories as us, although that can be encouraging. But it's about making yourself your own role model, if that makes sense. Because if you're constantly looking at somebody else as a rubric and you stop doing that self-work on what makes sense for me, then you're going to come at odds with whatever it is in the first place. Okay, well, I decided to be Angela Davis for my life, but Angela Davis is not Muslim. What am I going to do? Be yourself. And I think that if we look at life as a pursuit of making a space for us to be ourselves, and whatever that means in our different contexts, instead of it being our lives are built on being like somebody else or being the next whoever and being the first you, it becomes a lot richer because you're not thinking about, oh man, but they did this in this year and I'm doing this now. And I think, you know, being in my late 20s now to folks in their early 20s, that you're not gonna run out of time. We have nothing but time. You know, if we look at the pandemic, waiting has been a thing. You know, I wanna go to the beach. Well, you gotta wait. You gotta wait so that everybody can go to the beach, so that you're not putting people in peril because your desires and your need for an immediate satisfaction are at odds with what public health. And so don't feel like you have to get everything done before you're 25. Don't feel like you have to do all the things. Don't feel like you have to get all the degrees. And if you feel like you need to double major, maybe take some extra classes, but don't necessarily try to burn yourself out because there's so much work that needs to get done. So don't exhaust yourself in pursuit of trying to check all the boxes, especially when that checklist isn't even created by you. You have to judge yourself by a rubric of your own creation, not by those of your family, not by those of your peers, by something that works for you. Because if I was caught up, you know, like growing up with folks who would cry because they got an A-, when I was happy with a B+, I would be constantly pushing myself. But hey, maybe a B+ is what I needed to do and I can further learn or educate in a different way, but I'm not trying to shame myself for doing what's good for me. And it's brought me great, you know? Maybe like, you know, Osama who just chatted, we went to the same school. He went to Stanford. I went to Louisiana State University. We have different skill sets. We have different experiences, but we're back here at the same place. And that's beautiful. But we can't constantly put each other, you know, on the same race. Like if I was trying to be, you know, a medical researcher like Osama, I would not be doing a great job. And guess what? I wouldn't have written these books that are great, you know? So we really have to figure out what works for ourselves. And I think you'll like this metaphor. I keep telling a story that makes everything longer, but it's worth it. So the example I give is thinking of justice or life fulfillment as a potluck, and we all have to bring our own dish. And if you want to bring mac and cheese, because everybody in your family's brought mac and cheese for years, and that's what works for you, and everybody expects you to bring mac and cheese, but you have no dairy in your house, you have no dairy alternatives, you have no elbow macaroni, you don't even know how to make macaroni, and you don't have time to look up the recipe, but at the same time, you have freshly caught fish, you have artisanal mayonnaise, you have dill, you have celery, maybe you should bring a tuna salad, and maybe you can make a great tuna salad, especially because you just took an online course about how to make tuna salad. And if you try to bring mac and cheese, you're going to be selling yourself short, you're going to be bringing nasty mac and cheese, and you're going to be squandering this amazing thing that's presenting itself right here. And you have to get over that dissonance between what you want to do and what you are called to do and what makes sense for you to do. It doesn't mean selling yourself short, but it means being great in a way that you might not have thought you could be great before. Because a lot of what we expect of ourselves is based on our own limited understanding of who we can be. And that's because of socialization, that's because of society, that's because of privilege and oppression. And it also says, just because I can do something doesn't mean that I'm good at it. Maybe Dolores down the street, who's been bringing mac and cheese for the past 10 years, should bring the mac and cheese. You know, maybe you should bring the tuna salad. And so for me, the mac and cheese was being a direct, you know, action organizer, but that was killing me. That was exhausting me. I was good at it, but it wasn't good for me. And my tuna salad is being an author. Did I ever think I would be doing that? No, I'm great at it though. And I love it. And I feel like it's transformative. And I've seen folks being able to partake in it. It's being used for homeschool, but would I have chosen that for me? Maybe not. But it was my limited understanding of what was even possible for me. Because how could I write a book if I wasn't even a literate reader until third grade? It happened. And so that would be my advice, especially in your early 20s, is to remain open to possibility and don't try to make mac and cheese when you need to be making tuna salad. And I just love that life has brought me to a point where that is a coherent sentence. I hope that's helpful.
Okay, I think Mohammed wanted to ask a question.
Oh yeah, I actually noticed there's a question in the Q&A tab, so I think we should go with that one first.
Okay, perfect. Let me read it out then. Hi there, if comfortable, would you mind talking a little bit more about your upbringing in LA and how that informed the work you do today? Kiara is also queer, Black, gender marginalized from South LA, Inglewood, and it's so awesome to be hearing from you. That's what Kiara said.
The fun part about being from LA is that there's a song about every city, like little area. So like, I'm immediately like, Inglewood, you know? And that was particularly fun when I went to Louisiana, because it was just like, you know, so it's interesting. I think that I was uniquely equipped, not uniquely, but I was definitely equipped to be a public persona living in Los Angeles, where everybody has an agent, you know, child actor. We're all expected to have headshot versions of our, you know, like, elementary school photos. It's very interesting. It's also very much on display. And so being one of the few Black students in my like cohort in elementary school, I felt like I was a representative for all Black people, which kind of naturally progressed into me being a representative for my various identities. But it also took a lot of work to get away from feeling like I needed to be tokenized in every context, and that maybe I can just talk about being a historian and I don't have to talk about my own identities, which I enjoy doing, but it's about like, you know, I particularly enjoy being able to write history about Black history, but at the same time, I'm not going to give you a history of Islam. That's not my field of study, and it shouldn't be expected of me just because I'm Muslim. Like, what the heck? And so I say what the heck because I get emails like that all the time. And so I think that for me, growing up in LA, one equipped me to be very public facing, and there's so many acting classes and public speaking classes. Also put this expectation that publicity was necessary because you would see celebrities like just all the time. It also felt more tangible. So for my friends who were growing up in Louisiana, and I would be watching TV show and be like, oh, I've met them just kind of casually, not because you're going to any type of elite parties, but the fact that I was born at Cedars-Sinai Hospital in LA, and I went to school with somebody who thought that Cedars-Sinai Hospital was the like cradle of the Illuminati, and that's where they took Britney Spears and brainwashed her. I was like, that's literally just a hospital. Like, it's just kind of that tangibility of things that feel so mythologized. Like, you're in a movie constantly feeling in LA, you know, like, and it's the same thing with New York. Every time I would be in New York, where I lived for a while, and I'd see fog, I'd be like, oh my gosh, I'm in Batman, amazing, or a Marvel movie, which is better. And I think just that sensationalism really informed my life and made it easier for me to be a storyteller because stories were so part of what I was doing. Also, the queer element, you know, there was a queer kid who was out, whose name was Hunter, still Hunter probably, in middle school when I was in high school, and we thought that was so cool. It was like, wow, he's out and he's like 12, iconic, you know? And that was also influenced by things like High School Musical. Like, when I say it's a movie, like, for a psychology class with Mr. Bocconi in high school, we went to Dr. Phil to be on set. Like, what? That's not really, like, what? Okay, it's just weird. It's just different, you know? But it just felt so tangible. Like, of course you're going to be on TV today. Like, random. But when Hunter came out, it was just like, wow, that's cool. That's like High School Musical. We're going to have a gay kid. Like, that's awesome. And when I went to school, and it was still, you know, problematic though, right? Because I'm looking at people not as whole people, but as tokens to play characters in a story, which is still harmful. So it's not totally the good versus bad. It's a continuum of positives and complications. When I went to school in Louisiana, I think it also robbed me from being able to, you know, growing up in this kind of perfect bubble where everything was picture perfect, prevented me from seeing the harms. Like, you know, the fact that when I was growing up, I would always straighten my hair in the front so that way I could brush my hair because they only had combs for white kids. That's tragic. That's racial trauma. But I wasn't thinking about it that way. I was thinking about, oh, I'm playing a character too. I want to do this too. Not this should be created for people like me as well. So I went to school in Louisiana and I would see people who, like my friends, like the first friends that I made in political science class, experienced conversion therapy as the way that their parents responded to them being out. It made me feel like, oh, that could never happen in LA, but it happens all the time. Because queerphobia is everywhere. It's ubiquitous in the culture, especially in American culture. And so I think growing up in LA and then becoming an adult in Louisiana made me have this super idealized version of what it meant to be in Los Angeles. And like, everything's perfect here and nothing's problematic. And then going to Louisiana and be like, oh, it's the South, it's terrible. But that's so harmful because then we start looking at things that we can solve elsewhere instead of looking at how we can solve things right on campus, right, you know, in situ where we are. And so it's very complex, but I think growing up in LA definitely resulted in me being a public person, you know, definitely fashion elements and stuff. And also the way that I interact with things, because I was talking about with a friend, I'll close it up right here so we can get to the next question. But it's interesting because he was like, oh, I can't deal with the social media, it's so fake. And I was like, yeah, of course it's fake. What's wrong? Because he's not used to that. But I think that growing up in LA and being in California, whether you're in the tech industry, whatever, you know that there's a public image and then there's kind of a private persona. I try to marry those two things, but I don't get caught up when other people don't do the same, because that's kind of how I was socialized growing up. But California is a very unique and special place, and that's just some California essentialism for you.
Thank you so much for that response. It was actually interesting because I'm also from LA and I live like right next to USC. And then I moved to Lingwood, so South Central LA. Okay, I guess one of our last questions is from Anonymous. How do you advise we choose our major if we like it, but it doesn't make a lot of money and it's hard to get a job and everyone thinks it's a bad idea? I struggle between studying what I like and what will support me financially after graduation because the ambiguity and the uncertainty scares me. Any advice on that?
And ooh, preach. Yes. Okay. Amen to this whole question. Can you leave it up for a minute though? So, choosing a major. Big secret, once you get out of college, doesn't really matter what major you have unless you're on like a pre-med or a pre-law track. And if you're on a pre-law track, if you do political science, so have all the other candidates. So maybe also looking at taking classes that will inform you. I originally wanted to be pre-law, so I had done history, but I also took history instead of communications because the classes were open and I could graduate and I could be financially independent faster. And so people ask me that, like, what's your passion about history? Like, yes, I'm passionate about history, but also the classes were open and the department was willing to help me make my own curriculum. I didn't want to do an independent study at a plantation. No, what the heck? Terrible. And so they were amenable to that. They let me change it and work with the local African-American museum under my mentor, Miss Sadie Roberts-Joseph, who's the late Miss Sadie Roberts-Joseph, but totally changed my life trajectory. Did I think that I would be like, I mean, I got a history degree so I could graduate, but I wasn't thinking like, oh, I'm going to curate museums. I'm going to write books on history. I'm going to teach. I'm doing that stuff, you know, and inshallah, the museum thing, not yet, but maybe. Like I didn't anticipate that being a reality. And so really think about what your major is. Look at your alumni. That's a big thing to do, especially with Stanford. Sometimes going to Stanford is enough. Like, especially when it comes to the connections that you can make, start reaching out to those alumni networks right now. I did that at LSU. I mean, LSU, like the difference between whether I went, like the way that LSU was perceived really connected to how good the football team was doing. When I was working at Heineken and LSU was doing well with college football, I would say, oh, I'll go to LSU. Oh man, that's a great school. you don't know anything about the academics, but you think that it's a great school because of the sports. And so it really taught me, okay, then maybe I need to learn a couple things about sports to make myself a literate person in the realm of the alumni conversation. And so start thinking about those things. Also, just because you have a major track doesn't necessarily mean that you can't explore other options. Take art class here, take an elective there, unless it's gonna mess up your GPA. Sometimes that's important too. Unless you're not planning on going to graduate school, maybe the degree is what you need and it doesn't have to be the grades. Because another big mystery of college, I feel like I'm abolishing college right now, is that when you get your first, when you get your first placement, if you have solid extracurriculars, you have solid volunteer records, then what your GPA is isn't always as consequential. And conversely, if you do really well, but it's clear that you spent all of your time doing studies, unless you're going to a research position or again, like a medical school or some type of post-grad situation, that's not always gonna benefit you. So really, again, look at your alumni and see where they've gone based on their different majors and their trajectories, because it worked at LSU, might not work at Stanford. It really depends. And be open. Also, don't burn yourself out. You have so much life to live after college. Remember these things as well. Also, as far as the money part, okay, so that's the first part. So I like my major, but it might not work for a job that makes a lot of money. Remember that like the job that I have didn't exist when I was your age. Instagram influencing and educating still kind of doesn't exist. What I do now is called micro-learning because of Instagram Reels and TikTok. Didn't exist when I was your age. So also remember that there's constant innovation. So make sure that you get a skill set that sets you up for being able to innovate. You know, like the example that people always love to use is sociology. How does that work? Well, if you take a sociology class and people love to say that it's not wise to do, well, that works for marketing, that works for civil defense, that works for a range, that works for government, that works just so many different realms. So don't let the limited imagination of other people dictate your dreams. Really figure out what works for you. Another super important thing is to make sure that you have all the classes you need to graduate so that way you can explore and do other stuff as well. Because the last thing you want is to be in year four and be like, oh snap, I needed one more math class. So really take your education into your own hands. Don't leave it in the hands of your advisors. Don't leave it in the hands of your parents or the people who are paying for your schooling. Really put it into your own hands and get creative with it and understand that if you want to do something, maybe strip away the job title and look at what you want to do. Had I understood that I want to advocate, I want to make life better for people, and I took away the word lawyer, I would have figured out that there's so many other realms of possibilities, and I wouldn't have needed Angela Davis to tell me that and then drop out of law school. And so strip away what the title is, because capitalism makes us think that we're only as good as the degrees we have or the title that we have. And sometimes it's what we do that makes us, it's what we do that makes us whole, not who we are or what our job title is. So remember those things. And also, it's 100% valid to do a job that makes you money because you need to make money, because we live in a capitalistic society, period. You know, maybe you will make money and you'll be able to do the things that you want to do afterward, and you're not a sellout, you're surviving under capitalism. That's fine. You can't ever put people down for living in the world that we live in. You have student loans to pay back. That's not your fault. You know, just make sure that as you're doing things in pursuit of being able to survive in capitalism, you're not reinforcing systems of oppression as you go. So that means if you're a banker because you have to make money, you have to do investment, you have to do day trading, whatever, great. But don't duplicate systems of harm. Don't deny loans to people because they're people of color. Don't, if you're doing like tax law, make sure you're not going after Black queer folks. Make sure that you're not going after the most vulnerable folks in pursuit of a profit. So don't lose your integrity, even as we play the capitalistic game, and understand what that means. Because it doesn't mean that just because we're in a capitalistic system, you have to put all your morals on the table. No, you can be a good person to the extent that we can under capitalism, but also understanding that it's not a binary. You're not a good person just because you don't participate in it, and you're not a bad person just because you do. It's all about the context of the world that we live in and operating under that understanding and getting creative with it. Because if the civil rights leaders of the 1950s and 60s and before even looking at the 20s, were able to use the own terrible framework that resulted in their enslavement decades prior to append that and to continue to mobilize, and we have so many more resources than they had, then we can do it too, or we can do it differently, or at least we can do something. And I guess the final thing I will say for this question is understand that you're not alone. You're not doing this by yourself. There's other people in your classes, in your groups who are going through the same thing. So don't feel like you're an island. Talk to folks and I mean, look at social media too for examples of this. I'm super open about the fact that I'm a historian who refuses to go back to college, and that's okay because the work that I do is still valid. I'm published, I'm doing the things, I have access. Some of the access does come from privilege, and it's important for me to deconstruct those things and to name those things so you don't get in your own head. But also that sometimes the work that you wanna do doesn't make sense for it to get done in an academic institution. And that's okay, because we're living in a world that is constantly innovating, and we have to look at whether we're participating in systems and institutions because it's what makes sense for us, or if it's what it's expected of us. And sometimes those aren't the same.
Thank you so much for that answer. I'm thinking like how well-versed you are. I'm like, and I want to practice my own public speaking skills now. So thank you for just teaching all of us and or sharing so much of your knowledge with all of us. So we're technically over time. I don't want to keep you over. I guess we have like two more questions technically.
That's fine.
Anonymous again asked is saying thank you so much for your brave work and your expression as a queer person who was raised in a somewhat conservative Muslim family. It is hard to feel empowered in my identity around them, even if I am not out. Do you have suggestions on navigating conservative Muslim spaces?
Thank you so much for this question. I actually get this question often. And I think it's important to name that, like, I come from a different context than that. And I think sometimes people think that I come from a similar context and they're like, wow, how is she so out? Well, I come from, you know, like I said, like my parents are super queer affirming. They're not religious whatsoever. They believe not so much in the, like being in a church context or in a faith context, and more so about how do you do the faith in action. So it's different for me. At the same time, I have family members who like don't understand queer. They're like, what is that? They're very much pledged to homophobia, very pledged to a very narrow way of being and existing. And my recommendation here is that don't get caught up in the hype of outness, because outness connects so much, surprisingly, to a capitalistic context. You know, the fact that we're labeling, the fact that we're putting a premium or a valuation on people living their lives in a context that is antithetical to living that life sometimes. How could I tell a young queer person to just be out without understanding the fact that there are laws and policies created to keep that person down, and that being out will negatively affect them? You know, it's like shaming my great grandfather for being white passing when he was able to provide for his family. It's not his fault racism existed. Yeah, it's, you know, it's interesting. It's a continuum, right? Because at the same time, he would make his kids who are browner skin sit at the back of the bus and act like he didn't know them. That's trauma. That's violence. At the same time, it's within a context, you know? And so you have to look at how your participation in things is harmful, but also understanding that outness is a privilege in the context that we currently inhabit. There's Spirit Day yesterday, and even the founders of Spirit Day talked about how these are LGBTQ young people who are treated violently because of who they are. Not because of who they are, it's because of our homophobic, transphobic, queerphobic society. And if we continue to say the opposite, it puts the onus on the person for being themselves and not on society for making it hard for them to be themselves. And if we say things like people are living a lie, I would love to tell everybody who I was if they made it safe for me to be able to do that. And it's not my fault that I can't do that. You know, and it applies to a lot of different contexts, you know, like not being able to wear hijab because you have to travel across the South while you're working at Planned Parenthood in my context doesn't make me any less Muslim. And actually it's sunnah to be able, if you have to hide part of yourself in order to protect all of yourself. And so don't feel bad, don't feel fraudulent, don't feel negative. There are so many different ways to be queer, none of which mean being out. And that's okay. It also doesn't mean it's forever. You know, my brother is getting married. He just got engaged. I'm excited for him. I also just got engaged. So sibling rivalries, you know, no, I'm kidding. And there are some family members who still don't know that he's gay, and he's about to get married. And it's not as so important for him to say, this is who I am, to those people who are going to be violent about it, as much as it is for just him to be himself. And so find your chosen family. They're out there. I see you. I hear you. I sympathize with you. Know that it's not forever. Know that there is another side to it, even if it means that you are never able to tell your parents this is who I am. I love myself. This is my partner. I love them. That's still okay in the realm of who you are. It's not ideal, but it is real and it is valid. And you are real and you are valid, regardless of whether or not you can tell others about it. And nobody can take that away from you. That is between you, Allah, yourself, the divine, the universe, however you want to call it. Maybe it's just between you and the world. And that's okay. And you're not any more or any less queer because you can be out. And I think that when we take away people from the context they inhabit, it becomes so violent because it says it's something wrong that you did. We did not decide to live in a world that is homophobic. It is the people and systems that have made it hard for us to be ourselves. So hold on to that truth. Don't feel like you're alone. And know that it's okay. It is hard. And nobody can tell you it's not. Everything you're feeling is real. Even in the moments where you feel like it's not gonna go away and it's never gonna get better, write down somewhere that it is, if that's safe for you to do. And make sure you don't look at others. You could have somebody who's out, who's proud, who's loud, who looks like they have everything together, but they're still going through something. So don't hold on to the things that we can't yet hold on. Don't look at the things that we can't yet hold on to as what's going to solve everything for us, because that's false. Figure out what makes you whole in the ways that you can be whole today. And don't put everything into that dream of being out. Make yourself happy today within the context you're in, because you don't have to wait to be happy. You can be happy right now in your way. And I might not be able to decide what that is for you, but you can. And that's beautiful.
Thank you so much for that amazing answer. And I just wanted to share the response, which is, thank you so much. I just wanted to say that this was the best event that I have been to all year. That's all. And then a heart. And then I want to pass over to our last question, which Mohammed is going to ask.
Yes, for sure. And I just want to echo whoever made that comment in the Q&A. Definitely thank you so much for just gracing this space with your presence and even just staying like a little longer. But I guess the last question is, for a lot of students, educators and organizers and advocates who are committed to progressive social change, they're doing work for this long-term project of liberation. So I'm wondering about how you define liberation and how you think we can best build and sustain momentum for liberation movements.
So it's funny, I actually did an interview for a magazine and I was on set with, everybody was masked, it was great, and far away from me. And somebody asked me this question to define oppression and to define liberation. And I think I must define oppression first, which is frustrating because liberation shouldn't always be in response to oppression once we get there. It can just exist. But oppression, I think sometimes folks understand to be flashpoints of violence. Somebody being murdered by police, by the police state. Somebody being denied a loan for them being themselves. Somebody being bullied for being queer, not being able to be out. But it's not that. It is everywhere. It is, I keep saying it, ubiquitous in the culture. And I've really noticed this in this past year, being able to be more present with myself, partially because of my sobriety, partially because of the pandemic and the stillness that we have, that oppression is everything. Like, it is when you are literally sitting on the toilet, just trying to do your thing, and you're thinking about the stuff that you can't do. And you think about the risks and the harms that you have. It is everywhere. So liberation first is getting rid of that. That miasma that exists where you just feel like, it's sometimes, and I think everybody experiences it, where you forget who you are. And it's fleeting moments, very fleeting. For us right now in the pandemic, you might forget that there's a pandemic. Oh, amazing, we love that. And then we realize that those moments where we forget are almost worth those moments where you remember and you're like, ugh, because it's just a highlight. It's just a little tidbit of light. And I think that liberation is just being ever present. For me, liberation really looked like me getting sober. It's not easy. It is work. It is constant work to maintain this like, kind of plane of understanding and existence that I have right now, but it is necessary. So liberation doesn't mean free in the sense that it just is. It's going to take work to maintain and to reinforce, just like systems of oppression require work to maintain and to reinforce. I mean, liberation will be everything from having such comprehensive sex ed that nobody feels like their testicles or labia look weird. It's minor things like that, not necessarily minor for everybody. It's things like not having to experience body dysmorphia because you are able to explore and know who your body is outside of yourself, and that we don't place so much essentialism with how our bodies look. it is being able to practice what you want, and nobody's saying that their practice is antithetical to who you are. It won't be absent of conflict, because human beings, we are conflict. We are conflict with the earth, we are conflict with one another, and that's okay. But it is figuring out how to respectfully, not civilly, but respectfully and with dignity determine those things. Liberation is, you know, it's like Angela Davis's text, freedom is a constant struggle. It's a constant struggle. And there are moments of it. I think that I, in my own limited understanding of what that can be, it's one to understand that it has never been for everybody. And if somebody's freedom is created on somebody else's oppression, that's not freedom for either party. And I think that there's something to be said about people who are shackled to the chains of their own privilege and the ways that that operates, you know, whether that's through capitalism, et cetera. But it's not going to be a magic wand that's waved where we have the election of President Obama that we all experienced and suddenly racism doesn't exist. It's not the falseness of saying that's even possible or true, but it's honoring these things. For me as a historian, I'll say what liberation is. Liberation is no longer are people denied their truths. No longer does history text in the American classroom isolate and reify systems of oppression by saying that it's the fault of the people who have been oppressed for the conditions of their oppression. It is things like that where we don't learn about enslavement only as it relates to whiteness. We don't learn about blackness only as it relates to whiteness or enslavement, but that we understand that peoples have been here and that the timeline of events, whether that's through the Gregorian calendar or the AD BC system, is surrounded with white supremacy. I want to break away from that. And so in some ways for me, liberation is a return to what can be and also the creation of a new what is. And that's going to be something that requires all of us working toward it and not necessarily working in the same way. And it's deeply exciting because we get to create this together and we have no way of going back. We can't go back to what life was like before the pandemic. There are things that we're going to learn. And honestly, if we do things right, it will never be the same. And it will be for the better that it wasn't the same. And the deaths and the people who have been sacrificed along the way will not be in vain. And in fact, nobody else will have to be taken away in order to create what needs to be.
Thank you so much for all your amazing responses and for everything that you shared with us. I feel like we have all learned so much. I guess just like, again, a quick shout out to all of the panelists here. We have 10 panelists who made this event possible in their capacities. So thank you so much. Thank you again to all the co-sponsors. Thank you so much, Blair, Imani, for this amazing event. Thank you so much for your time. You, I guess, technically went 15 minutes over. So thank you so much for that. So I guess just final note, I think it's just amazing how this event like just happened. It's been planned since I think July. So it's been 3 months of planning and it happened. So yeah, thank you so much for everyone who made this event happen. I am incredibly just proud of the way that it came out. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I'm so glad I finally got to meet Lina. I really cherish the folks who have kind of seen me on my journey. I just really appreciate this and never take for granted the moments where we're able to connect, especially in a time where we're so isolated. So keep on doing the great work, y'all. And if you need to take a break and take a breather, valid, do it. And my DMs are always open.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Good night, everyone.
Thank you.